Well, Rouhani is known as a moderate because he has rejected extreme views and tried to bridge differences, but he's also known as no pushover. Rouhani has a long history of service in Iran's military. He's a former commander of the air defenses and a national security advisor to a former president for 13 years. He's considered an intellectual. He earned his doctorate in Scotland, is president of Iran's Strategic Research Center, and is the managing editor of three quarterlies on science, strategy, and foreign policy. But he is banned to have a complex relationship with Iran's supreme leader, Ayatollah Khamenei. Rouhani has represented Khamenei on Iran's Security Council for decades, but he's also criticized him in the past as being too rigid in his policies. Well, for more on the Iranian election and what it might mean, we turn now to Hillary Mann Leverett. She is the CEO of the energy and global analysis firm Strategica and is the author of Going to Tehran, Why the United States Must Come to Terms with the Islamic Republic of Iran. And she joins us from our Washington bureau. Let me ask you first, when we're talking here about this man being a moderate, we are not talking about him by any means in Western terms of being a moderate.
Well, I mean, he is someone who was supportive of the Islamic Revolution in Iran, has been a loyal patriot to Iran and to the system, the Islamic Republic. He was not the reformist candidate. That was someone named Dr. Arif, who actually has a PhD from Stanford University, who dropped out of the race to make room for reformists to endorse Rouhani, to build a coalition with Rouhani's what they call a moderate centrist, centrist conservative base. So they've come together, they built a coalition, and they got just over 50%, which was smart politics. It's something that, I have to say frankly, my husband and I were just maybe two only people in Washington to predict that Rouhani would at least get into a a runoff race to become president. He ran a good campaign. He played good politics. He addressed his weaknesses. He took a page out of, you know, some of the best political playbooks here, and he earned the job.
And let me ask you then, what can we expect him, how can we expect him to be different from his predecessor, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, and is this really marking a new chapter in international relations?
Well, there's this myth that the Islamic Republic is a dictatorship entirely run by the supreme leader or whoever it is here in Washington that we want to pin the blame on for this dictatorship. We never take seriously the actual players, the political factions inside the Islamic Republic that compete and really drive strategy. Each of Iran's presidents, not only Ahmadinejad, but his predecessors, Khatami, Rafsanjani, and Khamenei himself, each of them were independent, strong-willed figures with their own agenda. I think Rouhani is going to be similar. He's going to be a consequential president with a real agenda. And Khamenei, the supreme leader, acts a bit more like a supreme court in one person, and he will be a check on Rouhani. The parliament will be a check on Rouhani. But Rouhani has really thought about a range of issues, from economics to national security, to social and cultural issues. He will have a real agenda and will be a real power.
But we have no idea what that is in terms of Iran's nuclear program or
how it's going to affect international relations. Oh, yes, we do. Rouhani was actually Iran's chief nuclear negotiator for years under President Khatami. We know exactly what his views are. He has written about them in a memoir. We understand that he is looking for constructive relationships with the West. That's what he has said. But he also was burned by the West from the 2003 to 2005 period when he convinced the rest of the power centers in Iran to suspend their nuclear activities to see if the West would lift sanctions in return. He was burned then. He's not going to make that same mistake. But he knows the nuclear file very, very well.
If I may just turn momentarily to Egypt, we're hearing in the last few minutes that Egyptian President Morsi is cutting diplomatic ties with Syria. What impact do you think that it has on a region where Iran is obviously highly influential?
I think this move itself may not have a decisive impact, but it is certainly another important step towards deepening the sectarian divide, which is essentially a Saudi-run strategy with backing from the United States and some of our European partners to push sectarianism to, in a sense, contain Iran, because they're so afraid of the rise of the Islamic Republic of Iran. They're pushing these Sunni countries, particularly a country like Egypt, which is in dire economic crisis, dependent on the Europeans, dependent on some of their Gulf Arab partners for money, for basic foodstuffs. They're pushing Egypt to take a stand against Iran to contain Iranian power and influence. That is a mistake. That is why I wrote my book, Going to Tehran. We need to stop making this a zero-sum game, the United States and our allies vis-a-vis Iran. It is destroying the Middle East. We need to come to terms with Iran, accept it, and have constructive relationships with these countries as they are.
And I'm sure there'll be lots of discussion about this in Washington over the next few days and months. Thank you very much indeed. Hillary Mann Leverett.
Thank you.